Hello friends, welcome to the wonderful world of stories and why we tell them from Culture Katha. In my last video on Goddess Draupadi, we saw how the Pallavas used the Mahabharata story to inculcate feelings of bravery and the spirit of war in their people. It's not surprising that kings found great appeal in a story about war, but often they were also interested in the epic for some very different reasons. For instance, several kings from dynasties that ruled South India generously borrowed stories and episodes from the epic for decorating the architectural marvels they left behind. One such popular example is, of course, the famous carving of Arjuna's penance and Ganga's descent in the Pallava rocket sculptures of Mahabalipuram. Yet, if there is one place that pays some serious homage to the epic, it is the twin temples of Belur and Halebedu in Karnataka. The relief work on the walls of these temples narrate several, if not all, important episodes from the great epic. Unfortunately, they are not all easy to spot, as many of them have been disfigured by time, weather, invasions, and plain cruel vandalism. I visited these temples recently and I found some very interesting panels that narrated episodes from the Mahabharata. I want to share them through this video to show you what my eyes saw. So let's begin our tour. Inside the famous Chennakeshava temple at Belur, I found this pillar that had like a million carvings telling a million stories. This one, for example, tells the story of the churning of the ocean found in the Adiparvan of the epic. You can see the Devas to your left, the Asuras to your right, Mount Mandara being used as the churning rod and the snaking Vasuki being used as the rope. If you observe carefully, you will notice a certain churning movement in the sculpture. You can almost feel the motion, the animation in these figures. Talking of animation, look at this figure of Arjuna shooting an arrow through the fish's eye. Yes, this is the Draupadi Swayamvar episode where Arjuna wins the hand of the Panchala princess by exhibiting his superior archery skills. His face unfortunately is disfigured, but you can see that his head is tilted downwards where he looks at the reflection of the fish in a vessel containing water placed between his feet. Also notice how Arjuna is identified by his banner that shows the monkey god Hanuman. You will find how this technique is used extensively by artisans for indicating Arjuna. This is another relief found in the Hoysaleshwara temple depicting the same episode, although I found Arjuna's posture shown more accurately in the previous sculpture we saw, which was from the Belur Charnakesava temple. Here's a depiction of yet another important episode, in fact the crucial turning point in the story, of Draupadi's molestation and disrobing by Dushasana. Sadly, these figures too have been defaced over time, although I think we have to be thankful for what has remained. This one here is a depiction of Arjuna's penance to realize the sacred and powerful Pashupatastra from Lord Shiva. In this episode, found in the Vanaparvan or Aranyaka Parvan of the epic, Shiva appears in the form of a Kirata or a hunter in order to test Arjuna's prowess. Both of them fight over a wild boar, which they both claim to be their target. It's quite an interesting story, which I shall be narrating when we reach the Vanaparvan. Look how Shiva and Parvati are depicted as a tribal couple, headgear and all. If Arjuna was a natural favorite of the kings, Bhima was not far behind. Here to your right is Bhima, shown fighting a huge elephant. According to the epic, Bhima had the strength of 1,000 elephants. See how here he has killed so many elephants and has actually made a pile of their dead carcasses. This relief once again shows Arjuna shooting an array of arrows. His opponent to your left is most likely Karna, who was also known for his superior archery skills. This one is a depiction of the famous Chakravyuha formation, which Abhimanyu knew to enter but not exit. As it's a very complicated visual, the details are not very clear for us to know if Abhimanyu has been shown inside the viewer. And this one shows the great standoff between Pitamaha Bhishma and Arjuna. We can identify Bhishma by his beard. You can see another warrior beside Arjuna, who may be Shikhandi, who turned out, as you know, to be Bhishma's nemesis. And finally, we have the representation of a wounded Bhishma lying on a bed of arrows. The person standing before him with folded hands, I think, is Arjuna. You can see the waves of water from the river Ganga that Arjuna brought to the battlefield to quench the thirst of the wounded Bhishma. So that, my dear friends, covers some of the most important and dramatic events of the epic. I'm sure you realize how the epic and its stories have greatly fired the imagination of artisans and inspired such glorious craftsmanship, and of course have stood the test of centuries of time. So do stay with me on this epic journey to explore the greatest story ever told in all its forms. Till we meet again, it's Tata Bye Bye, take care, and here's wishing you all a very, very happy and safe Deepavali.